In the Gallery of Art for the Sicilian region, located at the Palazzo Abitalis in Palermo, there is a 15th century fresco on display, which is known as the Triumph of Death, or sometimes, the Master of the Triumph of Death. A masterpiece of the Gothic Italian genre, the Triumph of Death depicts death itself, in the form of a Grim Reaper type character, riding into town on the back of a skeletal horse. On the left of the painting, the poor and the peasantry are imploring death to take them away from their worldly struggles and strife. Meanwhile on the right, artists and aristocrats look away, going about their leisure and seemingly oblivious to death, despite the fact he is riding towards them and appears to be firing his arrows indiscriminately, regardless of social standing or class. The Triumph of Death's artist remains unknown, but the artist of Palermo Football Club's death is well known. 10 years ago, Palermo had just finished fifth in Serie A, their joint highest finish in the top flight of Italian football. They had also finished fifth in 2006 and 2007 as the Sicilian outfit disrupted the usual order of Italian football in the mid to late 2000s, showing real intent to become a force within the Italian game. Whilst Palermo finished fifth three times in just five seasons, there was something special about the 2009-10 campaign. A youthful and energetic squad played with flair, invention, and a sense of fearlessness, regardless of the size of their opposition. For three straight seasons, Palermo beat Juventus in their own backyard. In the 2009-10 campaign, the Rosanero finished some 10 points ahead of Juve and came within a whisker of qualifying for the Champions League for the first time. Palermo's team was a mixture of excellent homegrown talent and some seriously talented South American youngsters. In goal, Palermo had Salvatore Sirigu. In Federico Balzaretti, Mattia Cassani and Simon Chiar, they had an almost entire back line of either current or future full internationals. In midfield, Palermo had Antonio Nocerino destructing everything in front of the back four, and the magic of Javier Pastore in front of him, delighting spectators at the Stadio Renzo Barbera with magic in his boots, his ability to beat players, and create chances. And finally, Palermo had Uruguayan internationals Edinson Cavani and Abel Hernandez combining in behind club legend Fabrizio Miccoli, who had the best season of his career, scoring 22 goals in all competitions and 19 in the league. Palermo were a highly entertaining and free-scoring outfit that lit up Serie A, with a number of comparisons able to be drawn between themselves a decade ago and what Atalanta have done over these last 3 years. There was a suspicion that Palermo would be unable to hang on to the likes of Pastore and Cavani long-term, but that had been the case throughout their rise during the mid-2000s. In the space of just a few years, Palermo had lost Luca Toni to Fiorentina, Fabio Grosso to Inter Milan, Al Mauri to Juventus, and Andrea Barzagli to Wolfsburg, along with a string of other high-profile departures, but they'd continued to reinvest the fruits of those sales wisely and grow as a club. It was a project which had begun in 2002 when Palermo were bought by Italian businessman Maurizio Zamperini. Zamperini first became involved in football in 1987 when he saved Fortissai Venezia from potential financial oblivion and set about revitalising the club. Zamperini sensed an opportunity for growth at Venezia, and with his investment, over the next decade, the club won three promotions and reached Serie A for the first time since the 1960s. It was a huge achievement, and although the club was relegated in 2000, they returned to Serie A at the first time of asking. For years though, Zamperini had sought to build a larger stadium in Venice for Venezia to move into. Venezia's current ground, the Stadio Pier Luigi Penso, is primarily accessible by boat and could only accommodate around 7,500 fans. Despite being full to the brim every week, when Venezia were in Serie A, they still had the lowest attendances in Italian football's top flight, and Zamperini felt the club couldn't grow without a new home. Unable to strike a deal with the local council for a new stadium, partly due to the current ground's importance to the people of Venice and the unpopularity of his plans with the actual Venezia fans, Zamperini decided to pack his bags and take his money elsewhere. He sold Venezia in 2002, subsequently launching a takeover of Palermo and taking many of Venezia's players with him. Venezia were relegated in Zamperini's final season, declared insolvent, and forced out of Italian football, only to return in 2005 in Serie C2, the same division they had been in when Zamperini took over in 1987. Palermo, meanwhile, were a middling Serie B side when Zamperini arrived. They had spent the last 30 years fluctuating between the second, third, and even fourth tiers of Italian football, and hadn't tasted top-flight football since the early 1970s. Just as he had in Venice, Zamperini sensed an opportunity and a lot of untapped potential in Sicily. He paid €15 million to acquire the club and immediately stated his intention to reach Serie A in his first season. Palermo narrowly missed out on promotion by just 3 points in Zamperini's debut campaign, to which he responded by stating that he would chop off his players' testicles and eat them in his salad. Thankfully for the Palermo squad, he didn't, and over the summer, they brought in the likes of Fabio Grosso and Luca Toni, both of whom would go on to win the World Cup with Italy within the next few years. Toni scored 30 league goals in his debut campaign, firing Palermo to promotion as Serie B champions under the guidance of future Swansea City boss Francesco Guidolin. Like a lot of club chairmen and owners in Italian football, Maurizio Zamperini is a bit of a madman. In any description of him by former players or coaches, the word crazy appears to crop up on multiple occasions. Even by Italian football standards, Zamperini was remarkably impulsive and rash. In Palermo's early years, this paid dividends, as he seemed to make a string of good calls, particularly with regards to recruitment, and his passionate fervour seemed to resonate throughout the club. It is worth pointing out that even in Palermo's glory days though, Zamperini was absolutely mental, with the manager a revolving door beyond almost anything ever seen before in the sport. By comparison to Zamperini, the Pozzo family at Watford are remarkably stable and loyal to their managers. During his first 5 years owning the club, from 2002 to 2007, Zamperini hired and fired 15 different managers. An average of 3 managers a season, despite the fact that during this time, Palermo enjoyed an era of unprecedented success, winning promotion from Serie B and twice finishing 5th in Serie A, the highest league finish of all time. In total, during his 15 years as Palermo chairman, Zamperini oversaw more than 40 different managerial changes. Within the space of just 4 years early on in the Zamperini regime, Francesco Guidolin was hired and fired 4 times, which should give you some idea of how trigger-happy the former department store tycoon was. In case it doesn't, how about the fact that in December 2015, Zamperini said his New Year's resolution was to go all of 2016 without sacking a manager. In the 12-month period, from November 2015 to November 2016, Palermo had 11 different managers. It is little wonder that Italians nicknamed Zamperini the Mangia Allenatore, which translates as the manager eater. During the 2015-16 season, Palermo changed managers more times than every other Serie A team combined. Nonetheless, Zamperini's impatient approach did bring success during his early years with Palermo. During the club's first season back in Serie A, the 2004-05 campaign, they were the division's surprise package. This was an extremely rare season by Zamperini's standards, as the club stuck with one manager, Francesco Guidolin, for the entire season. The club finished 6th, earning UEFA Cup qualification, although their success doesn't seem all that unusual in hindsight when one thinks that 5 Palermo players from that 2004-05 season would go on to win the World Cup with Italy in just a year's time. Despite the success, Zamperini got itchy feet and got rid of Guidolin at the end of the season, replacing him with Luigi Del Neri, who would last all of 6 months at the Stadio Ranzo Barbera. A 3-1 defeat to Siena was the final straw for Zamperini, and new boss Giuseppe Papadopoulou would lead the club to a new all-time record high finish of 5th. His reward? Well, he was sacked at the end of the season, of course, as Zamperini brought Francesco Guidolin back to the club. Throughout his 15 years at Palermo, Zamperini appeared to have a borderline disdain for managers. It is surprising in many respects that he never attempted to manage the team himself, since he so frequently accused managers of ruining all of his hard work and of holding Palermo back. Zamperini's lack of loyalty is perhaps best summed up by his treatment of Delio Rosso, a rare dismissal that would actually come back to bite him. Following the club's success in the mid-2000s, Rosso was appointed in November 2009 in an attempt to stop the drop-off that they had seen just over the last couple of years. He replaced Walter Zenga as Palermo languished in the bottom half of the league with only 4 wins all season, but they almost immediately went on a sensational run. Rosso took the shackles off a really gifted young team and they repaid him tenfold. The club lost just 5 games all season following Rossi's appointment, beating the likes of Juventus, AC Milan and Fiorentina, en route to their best league performance of all time, finishing 5th once again, but coming mightily close to a fabled Champions League place. Over the summer, Palermo lost Edinson Cavani to Napoli and Simon Kjaer to Wolfsburg, but Rosso recruited well, bringing Josip Iličić to replace Cavani and dependable Argentine centre-back Ezequiel Munoz to replace Kjaer. The following season, Rosso once again had Palermo fighting for European qualification, but in February 2011, the team suffered their heaviest defeat of the Zamperini era. Udinese came to Sicily and humiliated Palermo by thrashing them 7-0. Zamperini, much like Michael Jordan in The Last Dance, took things pretty personally. In a press conference after the match, he fumed, "Rosso has a 1% chance of staying on the bench. You can bet on that." adding, "The team has been completely destroyed. He has ruined my Palermo. I should have kicked him out at Christmas." Rosso was duly sacked, despite enjoying much popularity among the Palermo fans, and just 5 weeks later, following a poor run of form under their new head coach, Zamperini, brought Rosso back to the club, apologised to the Palermo fans, and described Rosso as an excellent coach. Palermo's form for the rest of the season was very good, as they finished 7th and reached the final of the Coppa Italia. At the end of the season, that's right, you guessed it, Rosso was sacked again, this time for the last time. The Palermo chairman accused Rosso of having no balls, and away he went, along with any hope of Palermo becoming a genuine force and mainstay at the top end of the Serie A table. It's important to note that throughout this time, even during a period of unprecedented success for the club, Zamperini was never universally popular among Palermo fans, and he was genuinely hated by many throughout. Zamperini's routine outbursts in the press attracted a lot of unwanted attention towards the club and the city, whether he was busy saying something offensive or just totally bizarre. What's more, many supporters felt that Palermo were passing up the opportunity of a lifetime, and that without Zamperini's meddling, they could really establish themselves as a top half team at least, if not setting their sights even higher. "Better to be in Serie C than to stay in Serie A like this," one angry Palermo fan once shouted at Zamperini in early 2016. It would prove to be a somewhat prescient statement, except for the fact that Palermo would soon be playing in Serie C with Zamperini still at the helm. Following Delio Rosso's sacking, Zamperini brought in current AC Milan boss Stefano Pioli. During the summer of 2011, Pioli oversaw an enormous transition period, with Palermo virtually buying and selling an entire new squad. Stalwarts like Sirigu, Nocerino and Pastore departed, as a total of 25 new players arrived. Bizarrely, although not that bizarrely when you remember who was in charge, having brought in all of his own players, Pioli was then sacked just 90 days into the job before the season had even begun. His replacement wouldn't even make it to Christmas, and Palermo ended the season just 2 points above the relegation zone, their worst top flight season under Zamperini. As ever, the Sicilian club president didn't hold himself responsible for Palermo's downturn in fortunes, and the following season, he oversaw 5 different managerial changes, with 2 managers, including the current Atalanta boss Giampiero Gasperini, being hired and fired twice within a single season by the same club. In club legend Fabrizio Miccoli's final season, Palermo were relegated. Following 9 seasons in Serie A, the club had been relegated, but they would bounce back as champions the following season, largely thanks to an exciting front line which featured the likes of Abel Hernandez, Franco Vazquez, Paulo Dybala, Andrea Belotti, and Northern Irishman Carl Lafferty. Over the next 2 seasons, Palermo managed to stave off relegation, but one by one, their key men departed. Paulo Dybala joined Juventus, Abel Hernandez headed for Hull City, Andrea Belotti waved goodbye in a €7.5 million move to Torino, and Franco Vazquez was snapped up by Sevilla. Without their firepower, Palermo were relegated again in 2017, as the club went through 5 managers in a single season once again. This time, however, Palermo's problems ran deeper than relegation. The hiring and firing of managers, and the constant incomings and outgoings had left Palermo with considerable debt, along with a bloated wage budget. Zamperini had resigned as chairman in February 2017, before relegation had been confirmed, and set about finding a buyer for the club. He thought he had done just that in the form of Paul Baccahini, an Italian-American entrepreneur and TV personality, and the two began negotiating the terms of a potential takeover. As part of the takeover talks, Baccahini became Palermo's new chairman, stating his bold intentions for the club upon his arrival. Baccahini told the press and supporters that he was going to turn Palermo into one of the best teams in Italy and a competitive force within the Champions League. But following more than 12 months of negotiations, during which time the club was relegated, when Zamperini and Baccahini finally agreed terms, the deal fell through when it became clear that the funds were not in place on Baccahini's part. Despite the chaos, Palermo almost made an immediate return to Serie A. At the midway point in the season, they topped the Serie B table, but following another managerial change and a drop-off in form, the club finished 4th, losing a playoff final against Frosinone. During 2017, it is alleged that in an attempt to avoid bankruptcy, Zamperini set up a company in Luxembourg to buy the Rosanero brand for €1 million. Zamperini is believed to have owned the company who made this transaction, which helped keep the club afloat, but flouted financial fair play rules. As a result of this dealing, Zamperini was handed a 5-year ban from football in 2019 and temporarily placed under house arrest for money laundering. Zamperini finally sold Palermo in December 2018 to an English businessman named Clive Richardson. But within a month, Richardson resigned, claiming that the extent of Palermo's financial problems hadn't initially been made clear to him. Palermo were then acquired by Maurizio Zamperini's former managing director, Daniele De Angeli, but within a couple of months, he too had sold the club, this time to a hotel and tourism company called Arcus Network. Palermo finished the season in third place, despite the chaos, but were informed that rather than a playoff spot, they would be automatically relegated to Serie C. Palermo's new owners successfully appealed that judgment, reducing their punishment to a 20-point deduction, which saw them finish the season in 11th place. But just before the start of the next season, this season, the Italian Football Federation stated that they had no option but to exclude Palermo not only from Serie B, but from all professional football in Italy due to the club's failure to provide proper paperwork prior to the start of the season. Their entire first team departed over the summer as the club prepared for life in Serie D, the fourth tier of Italian football. In their place, Palermo played their youth team along with the help of a few veterans like 38-year-old former Argentina international Mario Santana and 31-year-old former Monaco midfielder Mallory Martin. In the depths of Serie D, Palermo's youthful squad found a winning formula, achieving promotion as champions with the novel idea of having just one manager all season. It'll never catch on. The passion for football in Sicily is immense, and despite the fact that they were competing at an amateur level last season, Palermo's crowds grew to an average of just shy of 16,000, which would put them in the top half of average attendances in Serie A, and which represents a significant rise on crowds which had tumbled to just 9,000 in Maurizio Zamperini's final years. It is even 3,000 higher than Palermo's average attendance during their last season in Serie A. From Bari to Lecce and Livorno, Italy's Serie C is home to a number of former Serie A teams, most of whom have faced some kind of financial catastrophe in recent years, mixed with a handful of less established teams who are investing heavily in an attempt to rise up through the divisions. Next season won't be a breeze for Palermo then, unlike this season, but the club that finished 5th in Serie A just 10 years ago does at least appear to be on their way back. Former Palermo owner Maurizio Zamperini gave an interview with the media outlet Palermo Today in October 2019, in which he accepted full responsibility for his rash and reckless ownership of the club over 15 years and their ultimate financial ruin. Just kidding, of course, he actually blamed the citizens of Palermo for the football club's demise, claiming, "Palermo has certainly not been ruined by me, but by the people of Palermo. Palermo has always demanded a lot from me, but has never given any help to the team. It was they who gave the coup de grace to the Rosanero colours." Palermo fans might disagree, but unlike the young man who has just been struck by one of death's arrows in the triumph of death, Palermo aren't dead just yet. That's it for today's video, which I'm aware is slightly longer than usual. I'm especially aware of it because I'm now incredibly behind with all my work, but there was a lot to get through, and there is still a great deal that I had to leave out. I sincerely hope you enjoyed the video and would greatly appreciate you hitting the like button if you did. Obviously, let me know your thoughts if you have any down below in the comments, and feel free to subscribe and turn on notifications for HITC Sevens to see more videos by me in the future. And if you'd like to follow me on social media, the username is just HITC Sevens on both Instagram and Twitter.